Welcome back to Let's Code. I'm Chris Biscardi, and today we're going to dive into some code that I've never seen before. So we're going to do a little bit of learning on the fly here. Specifically, we're going to look at this newly merged PR into the Bevy main branch called Derive AsBindGroup Improvements. Better errors, more options, and update examples. Specifically, the example we're going to be looking at is the array texture example, which has been updated to use these new AsBindGroup options. So we're going to see better errors and diagnostics, which we really won't be diving into right now because we're going to be looking at working code, really. We're going to definitely take a look at the additional option types. In this case, the array texture example is going to use this option right here, which is a dimension. So we now, when we pass textures into a shader, as far as I understand it, we get to specify the texture kind of type itself. We get to specify the image that the texture represents, how to interpret it, and also how to sample it. So in the case of the 2D array example, we're going to get basically a XY coordinate texture that is tiled in a single direction, as we'll see in a second. There's a couple of other options here that are going to be really fun to play with, and a couple other options that I don't actually know what they do. So I don't know what multi-sampled does, but I believe we can set these textures and samplers as being basically accessible from the vertex of the fragment shader. My understanding for this visibility flag is that it's possibly performance related, but I don't know that for sure. So until we see performance hits, we're just going to ignore that for now. And then there's also the sampler macro here, which has now the sampler type, which can be filtering, non-filtering, or comparison. My understanding of filtering is that it's either for magnification or minification. So if you were going to treat the texture space as kind of larger or smaller than it's supposed to be, if we look for something like filtering sampler shaders or something like that in Google, we can end up at pages like this. So this is OpenGL, which is not quite what we're working with, but it does give us some indication of what features we could be supporting here. So filtering here is the process of accessing a particular sample from a texture. It says there are two cases for filtering, minification and magnification, which I don't see any reason that there would be any difference between this OpenGL implementation and what Bevy does, because Bevy, as far as I can tell, is just using what has already been defined here. So in this case, magnification means that the area of the fragment in texture space is smaller than a texel. And minification means that the area of the fragment in texture space is larger than a texel. So for the purposes of our video today, imagine texel being pixel, right? Texel is not a pixel, but just think about it as like a set of pixels. So for magnification, the fragment that we're sampling from the texture would be smaller than the set of pixels that we have to render it in. So we would be taking, say, for example, a 3x3 set of pixels in the texture and rendering it at a 9x9 area when we sample it out. And minification would be the opposite, where we would be sampling a 9x9 pixel fragment from the texture and displaying it at 3x3 in our resulting output from the shader. Now, comparison, I don't really understand. I think there has to be a function embedded in the texture, which I haven't seen before, but TBD, we'll find out together. So of course, if we get to the Bevy GitHub repo, we can go to the examples, we can go to the shader examples, which I've been looking at quite a bit lately, and we can go to the array texture example, which will show us this code. Now I've pulled this code down already and I've set it up. So we've got the main.rs here. We've got an array texture.wgsl, which if we scroll all the way down, we can see is a fragment shader. And then we also have this texture. So like I said before, the 2D array texture is kind of like saying we've got X and Y positions here. And this image is also set up to be, let's call this a 1x1 square, and then another 1x1 square, and then another 1x1 square. So it's an array of 1x1 squares. If we run this, we can see that there is a setup of cubes in a row. So these are 1x1 cubes, and we can see the array texture. So right where my cursor is, right in the middle here, is the center point. I think it's roughly 0, 0. and we can see the texture on the left-hand side starts at grass and then goes to, I don't know, this cracked dirt, and then whatever this is, water or snow or something like that, and then this like sandy-ish texture, and then it starts over and keeps going. Now you'll note that it doesn't quite do the same thing going in reverse. We get the greenish texture, and then we get the sand, and then the water, and then the dirt, and then the green. So we've got double green here. We'll see why that is in a second. But one thing I did want to point out is that we are doing this in world space. So if I take the X coordinate of each of these cubes, so this material mesh bundle is spawning a cube here of size one for each of the -5 to 5. So for X value in -5 to 5, so a line of cubes, we render a new 1x1 cube at this XYZ position. And you can see that the array texture is mapped to world space coordinates, not cube coordinates, which is really interesting and confused me at first when I first looked at this example. So we've got our 0, 0 texture, and then you can see that halfway through the next texture, because we've offset the next cube, it is rendered with the next set of textures in the array, and so on and so forth. So you can see we get this kind of like, it looks like a bug, right? But that is something we control. So if we take a look at the array texture and we ignore all the red squiggly lines, which I don't know how to turn off, then we can see that in the fragment input, we get the world position for the fragment that we're working with and the X position. And we do this little and symbol, which is a bitwise and operator with the number 3. What this does is takes the number 3 and turns it into a bit representation, and then and that with the I32 representation of the X coordinate. So what this means in general is that like the number 3 is some number of bits, right? Let's say that we are going from right to left. So the number 3 would be something like this. So the first option on the right is 1, which gives us the value of 1. The second 1 means we get a 2. This 1 would mean we get 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, that kind of thing. So usually we get a byte here. So where you're working with F32s, so these are going to be fairly long. They're actually going to be 32 bits, right? That's what an F32 means. It's 32 bits. So if we had zeros to fill out this entire space, and then all the way over at the end, we had the bits for the number 3, which are giving us 1 and whatever, then that's, I believe, what we're using to pick the texture out of this 2D texture array. So you can see when we texture sample here, we're passing in the array texture itself, the sampler for the array texture, the UV coordinate, so an XY position, and then which texture we want to use. So whether it's the first one, the second one, or the third one, or the fourth one. So this is just a fancy way of not randomly picking, but picking one of the 4 textures, because we'll get 0, 1, 2, or 3 out of this end. Other than that, we use a lot of the PBR materials that we've seen before. So if you saw the standard material video, a lot of these are functions that we can use from the WGSL scripts for the standard material. So prepare normals and setting the fragment coordinates and things like that, which makes these not super interesting, right? So we could change this to be different, for example. Let's see if we can get this correctly. I think we have UV here, right? So we've got in dot, let's just set this actually. Let layer equals 1 or 0. Let's make them all grass. So if we run this, I believe that this will turn them all to grass. So we've picked the first texture in the array to pass into our texture sample here, because what texture sample is doing is taking the array texture, it's taking the way we want to sample it, and it's using the UV coordinates. So we've got a 2D texture for this graph, grass, right? We've got the X position and the Y position for the 1x1 cube that is the grass. And then the layer is what the 2D array means, right? So we're picking either the layer 0, 1, 2, or 3. So if we wanted these to all be like the second option, which what, 0, 1, 2, that would be snow. All of these will become snow now. So that's a really interesting thing about array textures. I think that the way that array textures came around is because basically the same way that we pack sprites for the web, it was a performance issue to use a lot of different textures. So people ended up basically creating texture packs for the shaders. And that's why this 2D array texture sampling method came in. But other than that, we've got basically the default plugins, the material plugin that we've been working with every time with this custom array texture material. In this case, we're tracking the loading of the image. I am actually not sure why we're doing that. I think this shouldn't fail either way. Right, because we only want to set up the texture once, and we actually have to set up the texture. So this create array texture, we're adding as a system, which runs all the time. So we load in this array texture, right, which is this image again. And of course, there's a couple lights here, but they don't matter. There's the camera. And here we're saying that if the loading texture is loaded, I don't know why we're doing this or actually. The loading texture is either going to be loaded or asset server get load. Oh, if the asset server hasn't loaded it or our struct hasn't had the loaded flag set yet, so the loaded flag is just a Boolean value, then we need to set up our texture. So this struct will set is loaded to true, which will from now on trigger this shortcut here, short circuiting. We get the image texture from the handle. We set the array level, the array layers to 4. So we've got 4 textures here, 4 1x1 cubes that we want to pull out. And then we call reinterpret stacked 2D as array, which is really interesting to me because there's also reinterpret size, but I don't know that there are many other functions that do something like this. So I don't know. There's a sampler descriptor here to get some data about the sampler or the texture. Let's debug this out for fun because I'm curious. I've moved it. That's not good because we need that to not be moved. So before we reinterpret it, we've got this texture descriptor. We get the buggy output that we were seeing before because we switched it back to world coordinates. And then I think that I wiped my terminal by doing that accidentally. So when we debug out the texture descriptor, we get a label of none, a size of extent 3D. So it's what, 250 by 1,000. So we've got 4 cubes. So 4 times 250 is 1,000. So we've got 4 layers. This is still treating it as a single dimensional texture, because we haven't reinterpreted it yet. So we're gonna have to debug this out again after we reinterpret it. And we've got a 2D texture here. So right now we've got a 250 by 1000 texture that we're using for X and Y coordinates. If we run this again, then what we get after we reinterpret this singular texture as a stacked 2D array is we get an extent 3D of 250 by 250, which is our 1x1 cube. And we get a depth or array layers of 4. I think depth is one of the things that we would see if we were using the comparison filtering, but I'm not sure for sure. But I do know that we get 4 layers. Each layer is 250 by 250. So we can pick any one of those layers. So we've effectively created the texture equivalent of a sprite sheet, if you know what a sprite sheet is. And then we get into our cube spawning. So we spawn the 1x1 cubes. We use our array texture material. Our array texture material points to this fragment shader. The way that this texture knows to be interpreted as a 2D array in the shader is by us defining this texture with the binding of 0 and the dimensionality of 2D array, which is this dimension attribute is the thing that the PR added for us. So now we can specify dimension equal to like 2D or something like that. This will fail. Because we are calling the other function, I believe. So create bind group, backend direct. So we're getting this error at runtime when we go to pass the texture in to the actual shader. So Bevy does that for us. So what we've done here is basically created a misconfiguration. So our texture binding 0, which is this 0, dimension equals D2, which is the 2D that we saw before. But it was given a view with dimension D2 array. So I think if we commented this out and we ran this again, it would work because this is what's reinterpreting our image texture as 2D. But it does not work because the fragment shader requirements don't match the pipeline. The resource binding for group 1 binding 0, which is our texture, is not available in the layout pipeline. View dimension D2 is array true, doesn't match the binding texture sample float. Filterable view dimension multi-sampled. Okay, so there's still something else happening here that's setting this to the 2D array texture. I wonder if that's set in here. So we set the type of array texture to texture 2D array. I think there is also texture 2D. I don't know if this will work actually, because I'm much less familiar with the WGSL scripts, but you can see that I think if we continued down this path, it would. So the next issue that we have is unknown type layer. Layer being this right here, which we're trying to pass into texture sample, and is very likely defined with an if def. So let's find texture sample just to confirm that assumption. So back on the Bevy GitHub repo, I'm going to search for texture sample, and I'm expecting to see something in a WGSL file that defines this function. I don't see it in the Bevy code. So the next place that I'm going to look is the Wgsl spec. If you just search for Wgsl spec, you get the WGPU shading language spec. And then I think texture sample, there we go. So it is a spec level function. It is not something that Bevy specifically gives us. It's something that the spec defines that we need to have. So it's probably in the WGPU crate, not in Bevy's support for shaders. So in this case, we can see that it's overloaded, which means that texture sample can take a number of different kinds of arguments or numbers of arguments. So we're looking for something that takes a texture 2D, a sampler, and coordinates, which is right here. So we also have this version of it, which is a texture 2D, a sampler, coordinates, and an array index, which is the version of this that we were using before. So we are correct. I think if we got rid of layer, we would technically get this to work now. I don't think that there is anything else that we would need to do, but notice that it does use the full texture now. We've effectively removed the layering from this code. So from bottom to top on all of the individual cubes, we are using the entire array texture. So it gets sort of merged in here to fit. The sampler goes through the entire length of the height, and we end up getting like a quarter slice on each of the sides of the cube. That's it. I just found this really interesting. I'm really excited about the changes to the AsBind derive. I think that this dimensionality and some of the other changes make it a lot easier to actually experiment with things like this. So once again, the PR is right here. I'll put the PR in the description if you want to take a look. I'll put the link to the example that we just looked at in the description as well. I'm looking forward to playing around with a couple more of these options. I think this cube is actually going to be like a UV unwrapped cube texture, which would allow us to define all of the sides of the cube in one texture, or stack those together and get like an array of cube textures. We'll see. I don't actually know. Those are just guesses. I'm really looking forward to playing with this. It makes knowing about these options much more obvious to me. So hope you enjoyed it. Hope you enjoyed this dive into some code that I was previously unfamiliar with, and I will see you next time.